Money printing, the most taboo subject in economics. But if we are to believe much of the media, this is what has been the new normal. After all, it has been going on for a long time now in America, Europe, and Japan. The central bankers just changed the name to quantitative easing, or QE for short. No wonder so many YouTubers are predicting the demise of the dollar, the return of hyperinflation, and basically the end of the world. Even though central bankers have been doing this for years now and we really haven't seen a lot of inflation. Hi, I'm Joeri, and in this video I will not only refute the simplistic view that QE is money printing, I will also tell you exactly how quantitative easing is different from money printing. So keep watching this video because by the end of it you will be reassured that the world is not going to end in a blaze of hyperinflation. Okay, to be able to pinpoint exactly how quantitative easing and money printing are different, we'll need to discuss exactly what quantitative easing is. QE basically refers to a policy where the central bank starts buying financial assets on a large scale from the private sector. These assets are typically government bonds and sometimes bonds from big corporations that are very unlikely to go out of business. But in this balance sheet example, you can see that what differentiates QE from a normal transaction is that large-scale asset purchases by the central bank are financed by newly created money. In this case, central bank reserves, where reserves are basically digital accounts that private banks have at the central bank and can use to pay each other. Here we stumble across the first difference between QE and money printing. With QE, new central bank reserves are created, whereas with traditional money printing, new notes and coins are created. This is important because notes and coins end up in the hands of the consumer, whereas reserves end up in the hand of financial institutions. And this is again important because where money ends up first is likely where you will see the biggest impact on prices. This explains why we have seen massively increased asset prices in countries where there has been QE, but not so much inflation. But this is not the whole story of QE. While the central bank creates reserves, it also takes something out of the economy, namely bonds. This is important because bonds are actually used as money in large parts of the financial sector. And this brings us to the second key difference between QE and money printing. With money printing, the government spends more money into the economy, but with QE, this doesn't have to be the case. If the government doesn't simultaneously increase its spending, the central bank merely inserts one money instrument while taking out another. To make this point more clearly, check out my visualization of the monetary system, which I covered in depth in another video. If you visualize the monetary system, it consists of a monetary core of central bank money, first notes and coins, and on top of that bank reserves. Then there is a layer of money created by private banks. And then finally, there is a layer that consists of financial instruments, often used as money, but only used in some parts of the economy. I call this layer the financial crust. So when QE happens, reserves are added to the economy, while at the same time, bonds in the financial crust are taken out of the economy. But as you can see, the effective money supply remains the same. This begs the question, if the effective money supply is not changed, then why bother with quantitative easing at all? Well, first, it is important to realize that reserves are more liquid than bonds and can be directly exchanged for cash with the central bank. So when there's a crisis, reserves are super safe, while government bonds cannot always be relied upon for payment. Second, the interest rate on reserves is typically lower than the interest rate on government bonds. So what's happening here is that government bonds are getting scarcer in the monetary financial system. And what happens to things that are getting scarcer? Well, their price goes up, of course. And confusingly with bonds, if their price goes up, this means that their interest rate goes down. And since central bankers already control interest rates on short-term debt by setting the interest rate on reserves, they can now also control interest rates on longer-term government bonds through quantitative easing. So perhaps a more relevant comparison for the media, instead of calling QE money printing, they should call it instead long-term interest rate management. But this is of course not a very catchy name, and so I doubt they will ever do it. Also, there's a third effect that central banks are banking on, and that is that by increasing the quantity of available reserves, private banks can more easily expand their lending and therefore the quantity of private bank money. This, however, is not guaranteed to happen since bank lending also depends on people being willing to borrow. But more on that in my video on bank money creation linked in the top right corner of the screen. And finally, by performing QE, central bankers have made government borrowing cheaper by lowering interest rates. This enables governments to spend more, although governments don't always use this opportunity. If the central bank and government work in tandem though, then QE becomes more like money printing because money is really added to the economy and nothing is extracted from it. Okay, so that was a crash course on quantitative easing. It's about buying assets with newly created reserves. This makes the system more safe. Now, this might entice private banks to do more lending and hence creating more private bank money. Also, since bonds are taken out of the economy, the interest rate on long-term bonds will typically go down. And this in turn might entice the issuers of those bonds, for example governments, to start spending more money into the economy. So there are two main reasons why QE is not money printing. The first is that QE means more bank reserves in the economy. This is important because this type of money is much more likely to get stuck in the financial sector rather than ending up with consumers. Hence, it is more likely to increase the price of assets and reduce the long-term interest rate on bonds than it is to cause any significant inflation. The second key difference is that while money printing only adds monetary instruments to the economy, QE adds core money, and at the same time, it extracts financial instruments. This is another reason why we have not seen massive inflation as a result of QE. I hope this has cleared things up about quantitative easing, but if it hasn't, please say so in the comments and I will try to answer any questions. These were the QE basics. There's a lot more to it though. For example, how can QE be coordinated with interest rate policies? And is it possible to put central bank money into the hands of the people rather than of banks? Or how does QE impact inequality? If you are interested in these types of subjects, consider subscribing to the channel because there will be a lot more videos on everything, central banking, money printing, and QE.